If there are any questions or comments, we have a few minutes.
So, Sheikh, there's one question someone asked online.
No.
That leaving jihad, you said leaving jihad is one of the greater sins, and leaving it on the battlefield.
Yeah.
Now, what about jihad and nafs, becoming weak to our nafs? Is giving in to our nafs equal to leaving the battlefield?
So, the hadith mentions al-firar min al-zahf. Now, in this context, it's referring to al-jihad al-asghar, that the actual, you know, military conflict, if it happened, that is considered a major sin. Because by doing so, you're weakening Islam, you're emboldening the enemies, you're potentially doing something that could cause other Muslims to lose their lives. Because if you're retreating and running away in the battlefield, the enemy is becoming emboldened, you're breaking the morale of the Muslims. So it has a catastrophic effect on the battle itself. Now, when you mention jihad al-nafs, when you commit any sin, you're failing in the struggle against the self. So jihad al-nafs is much more broad than kaba'ir or sagar, because any sin that is committed, it goes back to a failure in the world of jihad al-nafs. So jihad al-nafs encompasses all sins. Whereas when we're talking about kaba'ir, we're talking about specific sins that are deemed more severe than other sins. So it's all relative.
Does this prohibition against praising oneself apply just to one's own spirituality-related items, or does it apply to all traits? Because it is a bit at odds with what the corporate world tells people to do, where you have to constantly keep praising yourself and making yourself look good to others.
Now, again, in this context, when Allah says, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, from the context, we understand that Allah Azza wa Jal, because, you know, tazkiyah is about spirituality. So in this context, Allah Azza wa Jal says, do not deem yourselves pure. Allah knows best who is pious. So in this context, it's speaking about spirituality. But in general, it's not a good habit to praise yourselves, unless, of course, there's a purpose. If it's the only way for you to get ahead in your career, then you do it with that intention, that I'm doing it, you know, for a purpose, not just so I can inflate my ego. Because I think that if it becomes second nature to you and you don't keep in mind that you're doing it for a specific purpose in a specific context, you don't want that attitude of self-praise to spill over into your spiritual life. But I agree. I mean, that's the way that, you know, corporate America works, that, you know, you have to kind of, you know, toot your own horn. You have to highlight all of your achievements to be able to move up the corporate ladder. So that's fine, as long as you do it with the understanding that it's for a specific purpose. It's a career advancement strategy, and it should not becomes something that's you know, a part of your nature. That's when it becomes problematic.
And also, thank you. And isn't committing a sin and considering that sin to be minor also considered to be a major sin?
Yeah. So there are many ahadith. The ahadith where the Ahlul Bayt list the kaba'ir, There are a number of narrations. Some narrations mention that there are seven. Other narrations put the number at 10. Other narrations mention 19. So again, I don't want you to think that there are only seven. The Imams are giving examples of some of the major ones. Perhaps the ones that mention 19 mention, you know, others, the other 12 are perhaps less severe than the seven that are mentioned, but they're more severe relative to other sins.
Salam, Sheikh. You
had
mentioned about Muawiyah trying to provoke Imam Ali alayhi salam by writing letters to him regarding his opinion about the other khulafas and things like that, and Imam maintained silence because he did not want to create any fitna and facade and discord in the community and disputes. What do you think, and what do you say about tabarra, which is openly done from the podiums?
You know, I think the Imams, alayhi salam, give us the best example of tabarri. I think you have to keep in mind that there are times when it's appropriate to criticize these personalities, and there are other times when it's just not the place. Because if you look at, for example, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq had 4,000 students at one time, many of which were not Shia. You have some of his students who became the heads of sects, you know, Abu Hanifa, Malik ibn Anas. If Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam made it a practice to condemn these personalities on a regular basis from the pulpit, these individuals would never have studied under him. Now, we do have, there are situations where the Imams alayhi salam made very sharp comments about the first Khalifa and the second Khalifa. There's no doubt about that. But the Imams alayhi salam, they're also wise. Imam Amir al-Mu'min, when he's the Khalifa, he knows that, you know, Abu Bakr and Umar are revered. That's just the reality. They're revered by other Muslims. And if the Imam alayhi salam publicly attacks them, it's going to cause a lot of discord. The Imam alayhi salam criticizes their actions, but he does it in a way where it's not going to provoke people and it's not going to lead to violence and fitna in the community. So I think that when it comes to tabarri, you know, our position towards these personalities is known. I mean, we don't want to mince our words here, but at the same time, we have to have the wisdom to know when is it an appropriate setting to discuss these issues and when is it best to remain silent. Now, our silence should never be interpreted as an endorsement for these personalities. I mean, there is no doubt that these are personalities who defy. These are personalities who defied the commandment of the Holy Prophet, who are responsible for the suffering that we see in the world, I would say. You know, all of the suffering that we see in the world goes back to these individuals because they took a position that did not belong to them and they deprived humanity of the hidayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen and of Imam al-Hassan, Imam al-Hussein. So we don't mince our words. Our position with respect to these individuals is very clear. But we have to have the hikmah of knowing when is it an appropriate time to discuss these issues, when is it appropriate to condemn them, and how do we do it? We have to do it in a way that's academic, where it's not just emotional, where it's clearly defined, and it's done in a way that can attract people to the school of Ahlul Bayt. Because, I mean, after all, that's our ultimate goal, to bring people to the pure Islam of the Ahlul Bayt.
Thank you.
And there's one more question someone sent. What can we do for the kids at home when our local Shia community is lacking? What are the major things that are important to do for them as parents?
You mean when there is no community to take them to?
When there's no community, or if the community is too small to provide the full experience that, like, you feel like the kids need to have?
You know, I think it's difficult, but you have to create that atmosphere at home. You know, if there's another Muslim family in the area coming together for Dua Kumail, you know, taking trips together, you know, camping trips where you add some spiritual dimension to it, taking, you know, your family on ziyarah trips and connecting them to their religious roots. You know, alhamdulillah, with YouTube and social media, we have a lot of resources at our disposal. But it's really about putting together a structure, you know, setting aside time during the week for our Islamic education, you know, and that's something that the parents have to do, and you have to make it fun as well, you know. So, for example, if you designate a certain day for, you know, Islamic training, you know, make it a fun day where, you know, they have a recreational activity, and then part of that activity includes recitation of Quran, Quranic discussion. You pick one verse of the Quran, and you try to generate some healthy discussion. So doing that is your responsibility. And we do have a lot of resources online where you can find some material, but it definitely requires a lot of homework on the part of the parents. It's a lot more difficult when you don't have a center to take them to. You have to take on the initiative yourself. You have to make a schedule. I think that if you actually put it in your schedule that, you know, for example, Saturday we're going to go swimming or we're going to go play basketball, and then inshallah after that we're going to get together with some friends and assign someone to lead the discussion, to facilitate the discussion. We're going to discuss this ayah after basketball, after volleyball, after tennis for 30 minutes to an hour on a weekly basis. This is a very healthy sunnah to establish in our families, where you make the Quran a part of your life. And I'll tell you what I do with my own family, inshallah, when my daughter gets a little bit older, you know, we're going to have a whiteboard in her room, and we're going to have an ayah of the week where we basically discuss this verse, you know, during the week. We have a hadith of the week where over dinner, when we're sitting together, we kind of reflect on the meaning of this verse. We try to memorize it. So we make the Quran a part of our family discussions, where we go beyond just, you know, the praying and the fasting. We try to create a generation of Quranically centric people who think using the Quran, who look at the word, who look at the world through the lens of the Holy Quran and the Ahadith of the Ahlul Bayt. And parents have to set the example. You know, your kids are not, they're not going to practice this if you guys don't. So as parents, you have to get into the habit of making the Quran an integral part of your life, and inshallah, your children will follow suit. And again, don't underestimate the value of that element of fun. So, you know, religion doesn't have to be boring. You know, once a week, you should have an activity that you do with the family. Play a sport together, go out, you know, go to the park, and kind of incorporate religious learning in the process.
And are there any specific books or websites that you would recommend?
For children?
For children, yes.
I would have to do a bit of research. I mean, you know, with me, I'm just kind of, I'm going to try to just do it organically with my family, but I'll look into it. And if I find something, I'll definitely share it. I know that on YouTube, they have some videos where they have animations. You know, they take some of the short surahs of the Quran and they give an animated tafsir of it. But again, that tafsir is not entirely based on the interpretation of the Ahlul Bayt. You know, hopefully if Allah gives me the tawfiq, you know, perhaps we'll try to put something together that is in accordance with the interpretation of the Ahlul Bayt.